or Dr. Boz, I lost all this weight and I know you talk about autophagy, but I still have all this flabby skin. How do I get that to go away? Another place that really fits into this teachable lesson is I have had a weight loss stall and I just don't know what to do. I feel like I'm doing everything right. I just can't find a way to fast any longer. What could I do? The other ones are I've lost the weight, but my energy seems to be low, or I feel very distracted. So I've done some really great videos inside the course that go into some advanced endocrine processes, but I'm going to focus today on when I look at these problems, what these patients are really all, or these viewers are all really asking about is, Dr. Boz, how do I increase my growth hormone? Growth hormone is this amazing hormone within our bodies, and you might guess by the name that it makes things grow. When you're a teenager, it is going the highest in our bodies. The highest levels of growth hormone happen during that time right after puberty until they've probably around their mid-20s, if they're healthy. You can have insulin resistance, you can have obesity, you can have major health problems like cancer and chemotherapy that really do sabotage the development of growth hormone. But I always think of, let's look at what life looks like without growth hormone, and then let's look at it when we replace it. So low growth hormone, and I specifically put in there HGH, because when I say that, people are able to connect the dots that, yes, you can find this on the market of advanced athletes. Human growth hormone is something you can inject. And when you look at what medicine tries to use human growth hormone for, the low growth hormone you get a sense that it's low when they complain of things like, Doc, I'm tired all the time. I just can't seem to keep up. I can really only focus for a couple of hours and then I lose my energy. They're stuck in a constant state of depression despite all the things we've tried to do to raise that. They're worried about decreased muscle mass, which again, HGH and athletes, they're growing their muscle mass. So the opposite of that is they have a decreased amount of strength, a decreased amount of mass. When you look at skin, I've had a few people say, gee, my skin looks thinner. I feel like I can just really run my fingers over it and cause bruising under the skin. And you say, well, if you want to see one of the causes for thin skin, it's that their growth hormone has just been low and not really ever surged like it should. Increased fatty growth. So we have folks who have fatty tumors. When growth hormone is low, those fatty tumors kind of grow wild. They can get really large and they can grow up a whole crop of them. You have slow thinking and you have a decreased bone density when growth hormone is low. And the list is about two chapters long, but these are some of the things that commonly come into the clinic and patients ask about, and I will be thinking in my mind, boy, they have the syndrome. They have a syndrome of their growth hormone is low. So, like I said, if you look at growth hormone, it stimulates growth. It grows things. So once puberty is over, you can see that growth hormone is a very big stimulator for an immune system. It's linked to a thick head of hair, thicker skin, better fingernails. But it's also a stimulus for liver cell turnover, bones increasing their density, nerve repair and nerve growth, as well as muscle tissue growth. Other things that I think are worth pointing out is if I start to replace growth hormone, or if somebody replaces their own growth hormone, it does improve their energy. It increases their metabolism. It stimulates specifically fat loss, and it protects against muscle loss, which I wish I could encapsulate that saying it's a really big deal. If you have a nice hearty growth hormone, you're really going to have a difficult time getting that, I like to call it the skinny old man syndrome, where they're just, their muscle mass has gone all to pieces. Growth hormone brightens the mood, it suppresses appetite, and it boosts sex drive. So growth hormone is the bomb. It really is this hormone that if you want to feel great, I get why people inject it. But I don't want you to do that, actually. Injecting growth hormone it's difficult. It can be done, and if you look across for folks that have gotten into trouble with it, whether they're athletes or even just taking it and to look better. You will find that overshooting it causes some gnarly problems. Their frontal bossing, which is their forehead, becomes very prominent. They do have mammary stimulation, so you see the most common reason for a breast tissue removal is somebody who's had overuse of growth hormone. The other places that it does really change the way your sex hormones work, there's a lot of other things that go on inside about what happens when you ask the physician or you inject growth hormone and how poorly it matches to the very flexible and oscillating needs of growth hormone. Having said that, growth hormone is made out of fat. And so it is one of those fat-based hormones that in a high insulin or high carbohydrate diet, if they've been overweight and insulin resistant for a long time, not only is the fat all locked away in their cells, difficult to turn that into hormone, but the resources for building growth hormone are kind of all sleepy. They're hibernating. They're not really in good shape. So it can take quite a while to repair their growth hormone. So on this channel, you've heard me talk about a lot of times when we study healthy people versus we study folks who have been insulin resistant and folks that show up at an internal medicine clinic with years of high glucose. Growth hormone is measured. It's kind of hard to measure it because it changes so much, but this specific presentation shows you how high the growth hormone peaked in that 24-hour period. And you can watch that healthy people, and again, I really need you to think about this before I go to the next slide. Healthy people, they saw that in the first 24 hours, they had a little bit of spike of their growth hormone. By the time they fasted 48 hours, they made a lot more growth hormone. And if they could get to 72 hours of fasting, they made a great amount of growth hormone. When you look at some of the opposite ends of the spectrum, those folks who've been overweight with high insulin for many years, and then we look at their growth hormone, and again, we measure the same day with same way as before we peak, look at the peak amount in 24 hours. They fast for 24 hours and they really didn't even make it to 5 nanograms per milliliter. They look at 48 hours of fasting, didn't do much actually. And they get out to 72 hours and they didn't have much either. So they, you know, duct taped their mouth closed and they said, "Doc, I went 72 hours without fasting. Do you think my growth hormone got better?" And if they are insulin resistant, I'm saying, what are you doing? Do not do that. You are too early in the ketogenic journey to do this level of stress on your body. And it's a lot. I mean, fasting for 72 hours is hard. I mean, I do this, but it's hard. And you want to see that their body is responding and they're having a good Dr. Boz ratio. But you'll see the folks that write into the channel say, "I just can't get my ketones to surge. I just can't seem to get that Dr. Boz ratio at what you say I should be able to." And instantly my brain goes to, they're low on growth hormone. And how else could we stimulate that besides denying them food? Because unfortunately, that's just a shadow of showing you what did it look like for the healthy people. It was so much higher. I mean, all 3 days of not going with food in the people who are overweight or insulin resistant, they never got to the baseline that those folks had in 24 hours that were healthy. Sadly, if we took that story and we followed it, not just for a few hours, or 72 hours, but we went out over a month and we watched that growth hormone, those first 3 days, pretty dismal, really didn't get up to 5. But then we start to add 7 days of fasting and we get out to 10 days of fasting and we get out to 14 days of fasting. Oh my goodness, look at this. So finally, somewhere at the end of the month, 28 days of fasting, and you can see we're almost to the level of growth hormone that the healthy people had in 24 hours. By the end of 5 weeks, they are really still underproducing for that growth hormone. And it's not due to a lack of effort. They're trying. They want their bodies to do this. And they see all the benefits that if they could only get that growth hormone to stimulate harder, faster, and more consistently without something as difficult as fasting. And so that's where you start to look at what else could you do? What else could be the answer for somebody who's struggling with their growth hormone? And the answer is, in many ways, a sauna. It induces your heat shock proteins, really helping your body to figure out which proteins should be replicating and which ones aren't in a healthy enough form, or maybe they're wound up and folded in a way that aren't correct. A sauna has very good data for increasing and stimulating growth hormone, and it improves insulin sensitivity.
Please subscribe to my channel, and don't forget to click the notification bell so you don't miss out on any new videos. Stay tuned.